Hi, I'm Greg Lewis. I'm a researcher in Microsoft Research New England. I'm delighted to welcome you to this session on challenges and opportunities in causal machine learning, which I'll be presenting with my colleagues, Cheng Zhang, Amit Sharma, and Emre Kitcherman. What I'd like to do to start out is to zoom out a bit and talk about machine learning more generally. Machine learning has achieved great success in recent years. Deep learning in particular has enabled us to learn complex patterns from thousands or even millions of features, enabling such feats as object recognition, machine translation, and deep reinforcement learning for games that allowed us to play games like Go and StarCraft, you know, almost perfectly. Generative models have created new works of art and literature. My Random Phrases plus GPT-3 are basically poetry. Well, maybe not quite. But there are a number of challenges that we haven't really made that much progress on thus far. And these are the what-if problems that are about predicting what will happen to an individual or a system after we make some sort of intervention. And by an intervention, I mean a lot of commonplace things that we're interested in understanding. So what will happen to someone suffering from depression if they take some new drug? Or will adding a fertilizer to soil improve plant growth? Or will showing a consumer an ad increase the probability that they buy the product? Or will helping our customers by making investments in their business grow our business with them subsequently in the future? Or what will happen if our self-driving car breaks right now? These prediction tasks are fundamentally harder because the data can only reflect one of the possibilities. In the data, either the car braked or it kept driving. And what we'd like to know is what would have happened in the counterfactual scenario. This is hard to know, and this is the fundamental problem of causal inference. Now, one approach to this problem is to fill in the missing data by finding a similar instance. But this can go pretty badly wrong. Algorithms can find similarity where there is no real similarity. Or rather, if you look at these pictures, there is a lot of similarity. These are both images with a lot of stripes in them, but the similarities don't really have much meaning to them. To take another example, consider an alien marketing expert who's deployed to Earth to improve pricing. They compare prices and sales in the December holiday season versus the rest of the year. In the holidays, they see high prices and high sales. In the rest of the year, they see lower prices and lower sales. So they conclude, of course, that high prices must lead to high sales. As an economist, I could tell you that's a very, very bad set of conclusion to come to. And certainly you shouldn't start pricing very high in February based on this information. Standard machine learning is like that alien, trying to make sense of the world from data alone. And it's easy for systems to find correlation, but not as easy to find causation. So what then is the solution? Well, one solution that's proposed in causal machine learning is to bring in causal knowledge of the world in the form of constraints on the kinds of models that we might apply to the data. This knowledge that we're bringing in can take many different forms. For example, the constraints can come from physics, where equations describe our current understanding of physical systems. Our colleague Lester Mackey, for example, uses data from large-scale numerical weather systems, simulation models, together with historical data to improve the accuracy of weather forecasts. In biology and in chemistry, we often have some knowledge of which genes or molecules are potentially related, or the functional form of those relationships. In this case, as Cheng will discuss later in this talk, data can be used to discover the causal graph that describes the causal relationships between these variables. Constraints can also simply encode domain expertise, like the fact that humans like to shop during the holidays, so that holidays are an important confounding variable. Adjusting for such confounders is an important task that Amit will tell you about later in this talk. And techniques from computer science and economics can be used to isolate so-called quasi-experiments in the data from which we can learn the correct causal patterns. Causality and machine learning are fundamentally complementary. At the same time as causal reasoning enables us to zoom in on the models that are the most realistic by narrowing the space of models to be searched, applying machine learning broadens our possibilities. It enables us to extract signal from high-dimensional data where the relationships may be nonlinear, dramatically improving on the linear regression methods that have historically been used in causal inference. One such combination is the DeepIV model I worked on back in 2017, which brought together deep neural nets and the causal inference technique of instrumental variables, a technique Amit will talk about later, to uncover patterns in advertising data. The academic literature on causal plus ML, which was already big at the time, has exploded since then. So now it makes sense to just drop the price and talk the plus and talk about causal machine learning. The promise of causal machine learning is to deliver AI that is accurate, safe, and responsible. Accurate and safe because the models accurately represent the underlying physical or socio-technical processes. So when we intervene in a system, we generally get the results that we expect. They're also consistent with a vision of responsible AI as being interpretable and fair. This is because causal models use the language of causality, which is the way that most people understand the world. So in medicine, rather than having a black box model tell a doctor that the model recommends that their patient have a course of a particular antibiotic, a causal model might be able to offer reasons. It might point to a set of quasi-experiments that found in the data, showing that patients like this one, who got the antibiotic, subsequently recovered faster than those who did not. This is exactly the sort of way that the doctors would reason about it too, and so this makes a lot of sense. Social norms, such as anti-discrimination, can also be cast in the language of causality. You might say that a model is fair if race or ethnicity is not a cause of a decision made by a model. The same techniques that we use to analyze causality can also be used to restrict decision-making models to be consistent with this notion of fairness. And so having, you know, hopefully sketched why causal machine learning is an exciting field that can deliver many things, I'd like to turn it over to Cheng, who will dive deeper into the techniques that we're also very excited about.
Thanks, Greg, for the introduction of causal machine learning. I'm Cheng Zhang from Microsoft Research Cambridge. So let's dive a little bit into the causal questions first. There are commonly two questions. One is about identifying the causal relationship. This is a very general question in many fields among many different variables. For example, given all different health measurements, can we identify relationships such as if sugar intake is a cause for diabetes and diabetes is a cause for blindness? The golden standard is always A/B testing. One is come to identifying the causal relationship, which is very useful in many cases, but such experiments are very often impossible to carry out. The second question is about understanding the treatment effect. If one quits smoking, how much lung cancer risk does it reduce? Such question can be an individual level or group level and can be in many different domains, as Greg mentioned about. So these questions lead to research advancement. So first, causal discovery aims to answer the first question, which is to identify the causal relationship among variables when A/B testing is not feasible. In general, research focuses on such setting given existing data, which can only be observational data or both observational and interventional data. We aim to find causal relationship. For example, given a group of people's diabetes inheritance risk from the family, sugar intake, diabetes results, and blindness results as the table show on the left, the goal is to find the causal relationship on the right-hand side. The output commonly can be represented by a graph in different forms, but the graph may not be fully identifiable. From causal discovery view, the result may tell you that A and B causes C, but may not necessarily tell you how A and B generate C. To answer the second question, research in treatment effect estimation has also been advanced in the past years. Treatment effect estimation in general tells you if you intervene one way or another, what's the difference? In this setting, it answers the question, if one reduces the sugar intake by 20%, how much risk of blindness can one reduce? As Greg mentioned before, this is a very challenging task as you can only observe one way. Typically, causal inference requires the input of observational data as before, and the causal relationship as the graph show on the slide. The output will be the estimated treatment effect. Thus, let's recall again from a practitioner point of view. If one interested in the causal structure, It requires research in causal discovery to answer such questions. And if one is interested in the treatment effect estimation, and if the causal relationship is known, for example, from domain knowledge, causal inference is needed in this case. And lastly, if one is interested in the treatment effect estimation, and if the causal relationship is not known, one may require both discovery and inference tools to answer such treatment effect estimation question, or we can look into end-to-end model, which can answer both causal discovery and causal inference questions together. So let's have a look. Let's start with causal discovery. A lot of methods have been proposed in the last few decades. The method can be generally grouped into three types: functional causal models, score-based causal discovery, and constraint-based method. So for the first one, we assume a certain functional form from the cause and effect relationship and noise form to fulfill the requirement. For example, the noise should be independent from the cause. One can commonly unique identify the causal directions. And for the score-based method, in general, the idea is to track all possible causal graphs and find the one explaining our observational data best. And the constraint-based method commonly relies on independence tests to introduce constraints and find possible graphs that fulfill all the constraints. These methods have achieved a great impact, but many may have issues such as scalability to large dimensions or flexibility in function forms, etc. So with the success of deep learning in recent couple of years, we have started to explore if we can utilize advantage of deep learning for causal discovery tasks. DAG with no tiers is one of the work bridging the gap. It first translates discrete optimization problem to continuous optimization problem. As in this way, we potentially can make causal discovery scale to large data and enable more deep learning technology to help. Within Microsoft and beyond Microsoft, researchers have explored different methods of deep learning to help causal discovery. I just listed a few examples here. I want to highlight the VCause work from our team recently. We built a model based on variational graph autoencoder for causal discovery. Please have a look for paper. In general, these methods advance the state-of-the-art result of causal discovery, especially in large systems. However, many of them can be used for general prediction tasks in machine learning, leading to more robust prediction methods, which Emre will talk about later. We are very excited about the direction where causal discovery and deep learning emerges. Now, we have causal discovery tools to take existing data and output the causal relationship. I would like to show you how can we make a real-world impact with such technology as part of our project Azure. One example is that we would like to shape the curriculum that the student can learn best in education setting, using existing student quiz data and finding the relationship among all possible topics can inspire an expert to plan the teaching curriculum. So, partnered with an online education company called ED and Oxford University Press, we use our VCause model to discover the causal relationship among all topics and provide the results to the expert. They found the results very inspiring and have modified the curriculum based on our insights. For example, the results show that the Venn diagram is a cause for many topics in year 8 to 10. And they realize that it is used very often to form questions for other topics. And now they plan to teach Venn diagrams in year 7 instead of year 9 before. Beyond education, within Microsoft, we use causal discovery models to impact energy industry, business decision making, healthcare, etc., in partner within and beyond Microsoft, and in collaboration among all researchers in Microsoft. You will hear some of them in the later talks in the session. As exciting as the field sounds, there are still many challenges in the research. And if we could further advance the research, we can make even more impact in real-world applications. Just to name a few challenges there we're trying to advance our research at. So first, causal representation learning. The examples that I showed above have a clear definition of variables, and we find the relationship between the variables. But in data such as images, we need to find a meaningful representation first that corresponding to the causal concepts. And secondly, real-world data can be massive and complicated. All methods associated with a set of assumptions, And this assumption may not actually hold in real-world applications, and we need to relax these assumptions. Moreover, we need to consider how causal discovery systems interact with the human expert and explore human-in-the-loop system. And lastly, for many users, inference question is a key, and we need to explore more regarding the integration or developing end-to-end models in Microsoft. So here, we work on integration of causal discovery and inference to allow more users to benefit from our technology. Next, Amit will have a deep dive regarding causal inference.
Thanks, Cheng. As Cheng mentioned, I will now go deeper into causal inference and explain how it can help us make better decisions. Given any two variables, X and Y, the causal effect of X and Y can be defined as how much Y changes if X is changed, keeping everything else constant. And this might seem like a simple construction, but this question is actually a fundamental one that comes up in many simple and practical scenarios. For example, consider a decision maker at an e-commerce company that has a rewards loyalty program, and they might want to know what's the impact of this program. So for any given month, they have the data of the previous month's purchases. They have whether a customer signed up for the loyalty program in that month, and then they have the customer's current month purchases. A specific question they can ask is, if the reward customers had not signed up this month, how much will their purchases decrease? Now, this problem becomes tricky because two things can happen, right? One is that it's usually the high activity customers who sign up. So it's unclear whether their observed increase in purchases is due to the rewards program or simply because they tend to shop a lot. To illustrate, the left side here is showing the world that we live in, where X equal to 1 is for the reward program customers who signed up, right? And here the sign up may be caused due to the previous purchase activity, as shown by the arrow from W to X, or it may also be caused by some other activities of the customer. In addition, the same previous activity also causes the current month's purchases. But the answer that we are actually looking for is not in this observed data, it's in the data on the right. And what's happening here is that I've changed the reward sign up to 0. And now the counterfactual question is, what would be their purchases? And note that as the graph shows, now the correlation between previous activity and sign up no longer holds. And this brings us to the fundamental problem for causal inference. We typically do not observe any data from the counterfactual world where the observed correlations are broken. So that's the right world that I just showed. And here, three problems emerge. First, the observed data is not sufficient to estimate a causal effect. It also makes it hard to validate a given estimate using observed data, since we do not have ground truth on how Y changes when X is intervened on. And finally, it also means that we need to make progress on what assumptions might have been made when the data was generated. And I want to emphasize that we need some assumptions on the data generating process and what might be the relationships between different variables in order to make any progress on this question. Now, based on what assumptions we make, there are three main ways to estimate causal effect. The first is the randomized experiment, where we create new data that breaks the correlations. So for example, the e-commerce company may randomize who is eligible for a sign up. This, however, in practice can raise ethical and business concerns. The second alternative is to use the instrumental variables method, where we try to find an independent variable that causes variation in the sign-up behavior and use that to simulate an experiment. This could be, for example, a promotional email. The third and a more popular way is to use the backdoor criterion, where we use the observed data and figure out which variables need to be conditioned on to remove the correlations between the observed variables. In the next slide, I'll go deeper into the backdoor criterion, this third method, because it's the method that's applicable to most observational settings. So here's the process to estimate effect using the backdoor criterion. Three steps. We first use our domain knowledge to construct a model of the world. This is represented using the causal graph, where the edges represent direction of causality. Then we need to find which variables are confounding the effect of the treatment on the outcome, Y. And these are usually the common causes, but we have an elaborate algorithm to compute them. And finally, we estimate the effect. Specifically, we condition on the variables that we just found out as the backdoor variables when comparing data with different values of the treatment. So this method, the backdoor criterion, has been a workhorse of causal inference for decades. In fact, in the 1950s, this is how the relationship between smoking and lung cancer was established. What's new? Well, with machine learning, the standard causal inference methods are now being transformed. For example, consider what if there were hundreds of backdoor variables to condition on. Turns out there's amazing progress on using flexible machine learning estimators for this conditioning problem in high dimensions. I want to emphasize, though, that the straightforward way of fitting a prediction model from all the features to the outcome does not work here. This is because the features may be correlated, and a prediction model that's just optimizing for accuracy on Y need not assign weights that correspond to the true effect on the outcome. As an example, let me just describe a promising approach called double machine learning that breaks the problem into two steps. In step one, we build two prediction models, one from the backdoor variables to the treatment X, and the other from the backdoor variables to the outcome Y. So these two models are effectively explaining the variation in X and Y that can be done by the confounders, which are the W variables. And now the residuals of the predictors actually capture the variation that is unexplained by the backdoor variables. We now use these residuals to estimate the causal effect in the second step of this algorithm, which just can use just simple regression. Machine learning advances have also made it possible to apply causal inference in new settings, and especially because now we can estimate causal effects for specific subpopulations, not just the overall average. And this can help us answer questions about intervention policy. It can help us decide which treatment should be given to whom, and so on. So for example, at Microsoft Research, we've been working on problems where there's a limited budget on providing recommendations to users. How do we decide who to provide the recommendation to? Those who would use the item once they are recommended? Not quite, actually, because some of them might have found out about it anyways, right? So we really would want to find the people on whom the causal effect of showing the recommendation would be the highest. So those who will use the item after recommendation, but would not have otherwise. And to make these causal inference methods more accessible, I also want to highlight that we've been building tools and open sourcing them for the community to have access to the modern machine learning methods for estimation, but as well as helping you in formulating a causal question and providing you different robustness checks to validate your estimate. You'll be hearing more about this in the second session where we present DoWhy and EconoML. That said, through our work, we've also realized some challenges to doing causal inference in practice. One of the biggest is that there's no cross-validation equivalent test. And so we are working now on developing multiple kinds of validation checks for a causal estimate. We are also exploring interfaces beyond the causal graph to provide domain knowledge, since people may not always be able to provide a full causal graph. And actually, for some data like images or text, it's not even clear that the causal graph exists at the input data level. I hope I've highlighted the multiple ways in which machine learning is useful in causal inference. I'll now hand it over to my colleague, Emre Ketcherman, who will talk about the reverse, how causality is useful for robust prediction.
So far, we've seen how at the intersection of causality and machine learning, we can bring advanced machine learning methods to improve core tasks of causal discovery and inference. Here, I'm going to show how causal concepts can improve a conventional machine learning task, such as prediction. We've already seen how conventional correlational ML algorithms are hugely successful at searching for and finding patterns in data, but that these patterns often end up being spurious and unstable. Time and time and again, some innocuous exogenous shift outside in the world causes models to fail. Now, causal machine learning, by using a little bit of additional structured domain knowledge, as we've seen in Cheng's and Amit's talk, helps to guide the machine learning models to focus on robust patterns. For example, consider this very simplified graph where we are trying to predict Y based on our prior observations of X and Z. This is a straightforward problem. Y is determined by both X and Z. So if we're observing all these variables, predicting Y is easy. Now, there is a little bit of a wrinkle. Naively, we cannot tell exactly how important X or Z is in determining Y. There's a multicollinearity problem here because X and Z are related. Now, we don't even need to know how important X and Z are individually, though, because it turns out that they can both potentially predict Y. So what's the problem? Well, here's the problem. What if I tell you that the relationship between X and Z is not stable? There's some policy governing this mechanism and it's going to change. Now, our task might be to predict Y under a new policy that we haven't seen run yet. We don't have any data for this new policy. Now, all of a sudden, a machine learning model that cannot distinguish how important X and Z are is not going to work. In a sense, what we have on hand is a joint distribution observed, generated from the system on the left. But if we want to be robust to changes in our policy and still predict Y, we actually want to learn from the joint distribution on the right, generated by the counterfactual system that includes only the stable mechanisms. Of course, this graph you just saw in Amit's discussion about causal inference. This problem manifests in many different situations, in health and clinical decision-making, in public policy and other places. Here I'm showing a concrete example from the advertising domain where we're trying to predict whether a user will click on a link. More realistically, the problem has many more features, many more relationships, and many more policies than are being that are being simultaneously modified. But the challenge is the same. Once we need to compute a counterfactual to decide to make new and different policy decisions, then our conventionally learned model is going to start making those errors. And the more we change the policy, the bigger those changes are, the bigger the mistakes are going to be as well. And this is the type of issue that causal machine learning is intended to address. So how can we guide a model to focus on only the stable relationships? Our insight in this case is that if we can experimentally randomize all of our policies, then only the stable relationships are going to remain in our data. Unfortunately, this is often really, really expensive. We're not going to be able to get enough data at scale necessary to learn an accurate model. So our approach is going to be to combine data from small-scale randomized experiments with large-scale observational data. To address this problem, we developed a causal transfer random forest method that combines a large-scale observational and randomized data together. This is obviously a random forest-based method, and the core algorithm is similar to other random forests and borrows a lot from honest decision trees. I'll just point out one detail of honest decision trees that's relevant here. In honest decision tree, the decision tree structure is learned from a subsample of your training data, while the node values at the leaves are learned from a different subsample. Usually this means you use half your training data to learn the tree structure and half to calibrate the values of the leaves. And you want to do this when your splitting criteria has a tendency to overfit or otherwise introduce bias. And this recalibration on a held out sample corrects these biases. Now we're going to take this idea and tweak it a little bit. Rather than use two random subsamples of the same training data, we're going to use our small randomized data and our large scale log data. We're going to learn the decision tree structures for our random forest using our randomized experiment data. As a result, our decision tree structure is going to reflect all the true causal relationships that are captured in the randomized data. Then we're going to learn the tree's node values from the large scale data. And the result is going to be the best of both worlds. The robustness of randomized data with the precision of large scale data. And the approach works. In our experiments in the advertising domain, we see error rates for click prediction under large policy shifts dropping by 40 to 95%. So we see how reasoning about causality can help create more robust prediction algorithms. Looking forward, I'd like to highlight three areas where there's a significant opportunity to improve further, not only in prediction and classification algorithms, but also in other machine learning algorithms as well, reinforcement learning, for example, that we haven't discussed in this. First, there's room to build more adaptive approaches that can use or not use learned knowledge of mechanisms and policy when they're applicable. Second is to incorporate richer kinds of domain knowledge and elicit this knowledge from people more easily. And finally is integrating fundamental concepts and algorithms from causal discovery and inference into the core of machine learning methods, from large-scale training to fine-tuning. To summarize our perspective on causal machine learning, we believe that ensuring that causal machine learning models adhere to stable and independent real-world mechanisms is really core to ensuring that these models work well in the real world. We think that there's an opportunity here to improve all AI-driven applications that operate in the real world by making them more robust, by making it more easy to interpret their behavior, and by making it easier to understand whether or not they are operating in a way we consider to be fair. And furthermore, by tying these models more closely to the real world, we think that this will enable us to extend the application of AI into new critical decision-making applications that really can't exist if we're not able to reason rigorously about the consequences of the decisions that are being made. Now, this is going to require bringing together methods from across causal discovery and reasoning and inference. And there are going to be many challenges, including rethinking how we capture domain knowledge and how we need to unify and modify and extend the fundamental concepts here, as well as deal with practical, statistical, and computational constraints. Now, on behalf of all of us, Greg, Cheng, Amit, and myself, thank you for listening. I hope you enjoy the rest of the Research Summit. We have a great day full of additional material, not only from Microsoft Research and about the causal machine learning related work and applications we're doing here, but also from some very distinguished guests. Thank you very much.